Welcome to the Virtual Foundry Podcast with Brad and Tricia.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to the Virtual Foundry Podcast. This is Volume 3, Episode 1. Today is Friday, February 11th, 2022. And the temperature today is 41 degrees Fahrenheit, which is lovely as we are in the middle of February. That's a whopping 5 degrees for you Celsius users. The time is 11:38 a.m. here in southern Wisconsin, USA. Today, we're going to be talking about debinding and sintering bronze and copper filament. I'm Tricia Cease, president of the Virtual Foundry. And with me, as always, is Brad Woods, our founder, inventor, all-around science guy. Say hello, Brad.
Hi, everybody.
So as I mentioned, we're going to be talking about debinding and sintering bronze and copper filament. If you've been around the Virtual Foundry for a while, you may have gotten used to the process that had been in place before. We've refined that process to make it a little bit more forgiving. We talked about it in the sintering webinar that we did last week, and now we're going to take another deeper dive with it today. So when we're talking about debinding and sintering copper filament, let's start with the equipment. First of all, you need a kiln, and that's about it. So your kiln should have a programmable controller, and it should be able to hold the sintering temperature of bronze and copper materials. That's the only piece of equipment that you need. Now, as you saw in the sintering webinar, or as you may have seen on our website, the Virtual Foundry does offer a kiln that you can use for this purpose. Now, getting into the supplies, you're going to need a crucible, some AL203 refractory ballast, some talc refractory ballast, sintering carbon, and you're also going to need a sieve or a screen, which can be as simple as a kitchen strainer. Am I missing anything, Brad?
I don't think so.
Okay, you're also going to need your printed part. Right. So, Brad, I'm going to ask you now to walk us through the process. And I know you've got some and photos to show as we go through this.
Right. Let's talk about the previous process a little bit. So the original process was actually developed 5 or 6 years ago. And since that time, I've been working on methods of simplifying it and making it less prone to failure, giving a wider margin of error and just making it simpler to use. So our new strategy here for programming the kiln, there's one ramp in the debind and there's one ramp in the sinter. So it's very simple. So to debind it, you're ramping at 200 degrees Fahrenheit per hour to 900 degrees and holding for 4 hours. The entire sintering process is ramping at 200 degrees to the sintering temperature. So it's 1625 for bronze and it's 1925 for copper. And that's it. So no elaborate sintering schedules anymore. It's been greatly simplified. The next thing that we've changed is we're debinding and sintering in two completely separate steps. So to debind it, you'll put your part in the AL203 like before, and then run it through the program I said, ramping at 200 degrees Fahrenheit per hour to 900, hold for 5 hours. Wait until it cools back down, dump it out, sieve it off, get your part out of the AL203, and put it back into the crucible. But this time use refractory talc. And the talc it's volcanic rock, so it'll tolerate incredible amounts of heat, and that's its main job. What makes it effective in this process is two things. It lets a small amount of oxygen get to the part, and it needs this at the very beginning, but it can't have it afterwards. Otherwise, the part oxidizes and the sinter will fail. The other thing that it does is it's soft and it will yield. So as your part densifies, it's going to get smaller. And when it's in the talc, like I said, it's soft. It'll move out of the way as your part needs space to move. So I'm going to put some pictures up on the screen here and we'll talk about them a little bit. So the one on the left is a green, so right off the printer, piece of copper. The one in the middle has been debound, so it's a brown part. And as far as handling it at this stage, it's actually remarkably strong. So we take it out and you can sand on it. You can actually manipulate it at this point. And then this would go back into the crucible with the talc, put some carbon on top of it. And then we're starting to recommend that you cover it just to conserve carbon. So if you cover the crucible, you will actually consume very, very little carbon and it'll last you forever. And all of these.
What is a cover like? What can you use as a cover for that crucible?
Right. It can be a slip, a piece of like sintering paper. It can be a piece of, and we're going to add this to our store, but it can be a piece of stainless steel foil, like they use in heat treatment. That works very well. We also have sliced up fire brick. So I'll slice a fire brick a quarter of an inch thick and just set that on top of it. You don't want it sealed. Air does need to come and go, the various vapors. But if you just keep the air from flowing over it, you won't consume any oxygen. And this isn't a necessary step. It's just less costly because your carbon lasts longer. Okay, so in the third one, this is a final sintered piece and it's been hit with a wire brush. It has been, and this one actually polished on a buffing wheel. And you can see the top of the cabin there is a little bit smooshed down. And this is because I didn't get the talc up under that bridging portion of the 3D print. So the next one I make will look better. And this is part of the process. Almost every piece takes a little bit of trial and error. Sinter a piece and make some adjustments. Once you get a process dialed in for a specific piece, it's very repeatable.
So give us a little bit more detail about loading the print into the refractory in the crucible. Like, how tight should you pack that in there? Are you smashing it down on top? Are you just putting it in very lightly as you do with flour when you're baking? How tightly are you packing that crucible?
In each case, so in the case when you're loading it into the AL203, setting up for your debind, you want to put it in there and just tap on the outside of the crucible until it settles. You want it to be, if you move it around, you don't want it to kind of slosh around. It'll pack in there and tighten. You don't want to ram it hard. You just want gravity to pull the AL203 down and get it settled around the part as best you can. And the same goes for the talc. The talc is dry, so it's very free flowing. It isn't like if you think of, it's roughly the consistency of flour that you would use for baking, but it's dry and it flows more easily. It doesn't clump up. So it will also flow through the part. So you tap on the outside of the crucible until it stops settling. And then that's when you know it's ready to sinter.
Right. So the two keys here are to make sure that that refractory is in every nook and cranny of that part so that every piece of that part is supported while at the same time it can move and shrink in on itself.
Right. And this is kind of a key breakthrough with the talc. The AL203 is too rigid. It wouldn't let the part shrink. It wouldn't yield. And it would cause micro cracks and fractures in the sintered part. And the job of the talc is just to be softer. And it simply moves out of the way as your part shrinks and densifies.
Now you talked about that part on the right. You've done a wire wheel brush with it to shine it up and maybe some ZAM buffing compound with a rotary buffing tool. If you don't need it to be that shiny, what is the minimum baseline that you'll need to do to clean your part up after you pull it out of the crucible once it's been sintered so that you can get a good look and feel of your part?
Right. So the piece is made of microscopic metal particles. So optically, when light hits it, it scatters. So it doesn't look shiny. It'll look like copper, but it won't have any shine to it. It'll be very, very dull. And this is true of pretty much any powder metallurgy process. You need some type of post-processing, well, depending on the look that you're going for. If you want it to look like a shiny piece of copper, you simply hit it with a wire wheel and then sort of buff to taste or sand or however you want to process it. And how you finish it, there's tons of information in jewelry making videos and things like that. So if you go out and Google copper finishing techniques, anything that you read there in jewelry categories applies to this at this stage of the process.
Now we can see that that benchy on the right is definitely smaller than the green benchy on the left. So tell us about shrinkage and what kind of shrink rates we can expect.
So in this, following the directions as written, you'll have shrinkage with the copper and bronze. They're both about the same. They both shrink by about 7.5%. And what's happening is that 7.5% is just space that was previously occupied by the plastic. And as it densifies down, by the time at 7.5%, you're in the low 80s as far as density. So it's quite microscopically porous. And this is desirable in some situations, undesirable in others. If you don't want your part to be porous, you continue to sinter it. You sinter it harder, either for a longer period of time or at a higher temperature. And by the time you fully densify the part, it will have shrunk by about 18%. But you can get to, you can get to 98% density pretty comfortably.
And how much shrink would you get at that 98% density?
You would get 18 to 20% shrinkage.
Right. And the more shrinkage that you're going for, the more potential there is for shape change, which makes that packing in that refractory and the use of the talc that can easily move out of the way even more important. So we've talked about the equipment, we've talked about the process. It's a two-step, basically two-day process, loading your part in the AL203, going through the debind step, cooling the furnace, repacking your part into that talc, adding sintering carbon on top, applying a lid if you have one, it's not necessary, and then running through the sintering process. From there, you dump your whole crucible out and you'll have your finished part.
Yes. And we, with all of our processes, our baseline instructions are meant to get you to a successful result. But it's a starting point. We expect people to take these processes, improve them, and tweak them for their own applications. But following the instructions, you will get a metal 3D printed part in the end.
Yes, right on. It's just like following a recipe. If you follow the recipe exactly, you should get the result that you expect. And from there, you can change and tweak and add or take away. We do have partner innovators that are using a refractory that they chose and made themselves. So start with the published process so that you get a quick success and then branch out from there.
Yes. People tend to want to take a shortcut or think there's something they can cut out of it. And they likely can with experience, but not on the first try. Just follow the instructions and you will succeed.
So what's next? If you're ready to get started, we recommend buying the Getting Started bundle in our shop. That will include all the supplies that you need to print and sinter bronze filament. We do also offer a copper print and sinter kit if you'd like to start with copper. Now, Brad, I have one more very important question for you before we wrap up today.
All right, let's have it.
What kind of money do snowmen use in the North Pole?
I don't know.
They use cold, hard cash.
Nice.
Hey, if you've got a cool project you want to show off in this format, we'd love to interview you on a future podcast. And if you have a topic request, something you would like to see us cover or do a deeper dive on, let us know and we can incorporate that into a future podcast. Thank you for joining us today from Tricia and Brad. Have a great day.
Thank you.